So we're nearing the end of our symposium, and I just want to thank you for sharing this space with us today. I want to also acknowledge the Symposium Planning Committee for their vision and creativity. This symposium would not have been possible without them, so I'm going to call them out, actually. So Linda Fargie's here. Where's Chamtoli? She was in the back. Oh, here. See, I shamed her to come up. So Chamtoli, Hoke right here, is part of CUNY Law. Where's Anne Matsuichi? Where's she? Right there. And then, who am I missing? Lily. Lily, she had to leave. So this is the Symposium Planning Committee, and I could not have done any of this without them. So, all right. Next, I'd like to direct our attention to Dr. Linton Varghese, who's faculty at BMCC and AAARI board member, and also I had mentioned a symposium planner who will be introducing our performer today.
And I'm just realizing this might be like the best closeout. I've been to so many academic things, and people often close out with a really long talk. And so I think closing out the performance is so beautiful and wonderful. So I have the pleasure of introducing Rohanju Lee, who is an award-winning international writer, dancer, and community organizer, a 2023 Open City Fellow at the Asian American Writers Workshop, a 2023 FIA grant winner, and a 2022 Bandung resident. They have written for Newsweek, Truth Out, Prism Report, Reckon News, and more. Spotlight features include CNN, NBC Chicago, USA Today, WNYC, AJ Plus, and more. Julie has spoken at New York University, Yale University, Oberlin College, the University of Tokyo, the 2022 Unite and Enough Festivals in Zurich, Switzerland, Harvard University, and more. As a performing artist, Rohan has made their off-Broadway debut in Over Here, the musical in 2019, premiered their contemporary ballet homage at the 2016 A Squared Theater Asian American Performing Arts Festival in Chicago, which was reimagined for the 2022 Unite Festival in Zurich. Their credits, other credits include Julius Eastman's Joy Boy on trumpet, Chamber Career 2021, and for dance, Francois and the Rebels, Public Theater 2023, West Side Story, New Bedford Theater Festival 2018, the HBO series Lovecraft Country, which is a really cool series, and Bluebird Bas de Deux, Victoria Ballet Theater 2019. Julie holds a Bachelor of Arts in Ethnomusicology from Northwestern University. And I'm sure there's so much more that's not on this bio. But welcome. Thank you so much.
I flew your kite, Habibi, based on If I Must Die, by Refat Alarir. Look, look, Habibi, I flew your kite, and I wrote your name on it. But it hit the ground, for the sky was filled with smoke. It hit the earth that should have been green, but now it's black and gray, hands reaching from the rubble like a forest in winter. The words freedom, democracy, and love is love, finger-painted in the ash, like an insult. So I dragged your kite, Habibi. I took it right through the mud, past barricades filled with bats and pepper spray, through corridors filled with riot gear and screams and the sting of smoke, beyond the destruction, books burned to charred remains like lakes of thought drained for production. I carried the kite, Habibi, past the corpses of fruit and grain, kicked out and rotting, the things the world gives to keep everyone alive. I thought, maybe, if I brought it, it could feed somebody. At least no one would think your kite was food. I held your kite, Habibi, wrapped it so beautifully in swaddling white cloth, like the precious moment it is. The smiles and laughter it gave you, the dreams it carried for you, how it tossed your tears away and turned them into clouds. It made you feel not so sad anymore. But Habibi, I'm sorry. I'm so, so, so sorry. Because Habibi, I gave your kite to the earth. I put it beneath a field of flowers, the colors of cream and candy, and it smelled just as sweet. I put it there so you could hold it always. But look, there's your name. It's rising up, 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 up. There it is. Don't you see it? Riding into the sky up above all the darkness. So thank you, Habibi. Thank you for tying its string to my finger.
So, thanks for clicking my piece. Another aspect of my work is I work in around Black Asian solidarity education arts. And on June 22nd, we have our upcoming Blasian Pride, celebrating Black, Asian, Blasian, LGBTQ community. So we're doing it through like food, performance arts, beaches, so it's fun. It's also going to be Juneteenth themed. So if anyone's like getting involved, or also like, donate maybe, it's tax deductible. But please feel free to find information about that at relationmarks.org. You can find me, find me later. Also, our Instagram page, I'll have a link to the information page. So, Relation March, LASIANMARCH.
Does anyone have any thoughts or questions about the piece, or me in general?
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, I actually did like your piece. That was really nice. I feel like, so I heard about the story, right? I just couldn't catch up with the story.
Uh-huh.
So you were acting and the story like behind.
Yeah.
Your dancing.
Yeah.
So I actually really like that because, I don't know if you know, I'm a piano.
Yeah.
So I dance on a piano and, I really like, because how you know, if you understand what they're saying, then it's usually about like the real life situations that happen, where someone's talking about where they came from, and they talk about poverty, and they talk about a whole lot of things, or they talk about being successful finally, or whatever it is. But I actually want to incorporate my piano to a dance, where I can actually like make it like sort of a theater.
Yeah,
but like incorporating different piano songs that tell a story, you know. So I wanted to know what inspired you to start the dance and more of the journey.
So this piece in particular kind of came about because I felt like I couldn't really do a lot in terms of like, you know, solidarity with Palestinians, any sort of attempt at global liberation, what can I as an individual do? And I mean, obviously I can do things, but like my emotional status was like, I felt kind of helpless. But as a dancing artist, it's almost like, well, I can at least create art. And I think there's something really powerful about using art and engaging art into politics or like your political like stance. Because I feel like especially so many times these days, I mean, ballet world in particular is so apolitical, but apolitical still says something to the masses. It still says something, especially people of color who have been so pushed out of the industry. And we all know in so many oppressive states how they have used art to manipulate people, or they have persecuted artists in so many extremist government dictatorships, you name it. You know, the artists get disappeared, the artists are the ones who are like forced into exile. So I felt like for me, this is almost like my reflection of like admiration of so many of the artists who are still brave enough to do the art despite what the state says. So like the poem I wrote was definitely inspired by what I've been, I guess, reading or watching in terms of Palestinian children. So like the character in the poem Habibi is supposed to be, in my vision, was supposed to be a child. And so this was like also taking and borrowing from Refat Alarir's poem If I Must Die, and how kite is like a big image of like childhood joy. So this felt to me more like the almost like artistic, like this is my showcase of solidarity. And even though I as an individual cannot like change policy right now, or I as a individual cannot like stop the military or stop the sales of bombs. Oh, Joe Biden, darling, have we stop. But at least with this piece, I can still.
Okay.
Yeah, I can still say something. I can still give something to people, even if I cannot, you know, do anything else right now.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, that's a very long answer. This is like a.
But sort of maybe reaction is I would say that I don't know, you should feel how you feel, but I would say that there's ways in which your dance and the way that you perform is says does more because it touches because so, there's such an empathy gap right now.
Absolutely.
So I just so I'm a lawyer and we are in the thing of but it didn't work, right? We went to the ICJ, we went to so this doesn't work. So I'm actually coming back to what are the other ways in which we can articulate our humanity. So I would say that you're doing a lot. Habibi is beloved. I was from Bangladesh, and so kite and go to the rooftop. And my first love was my first love is always dance movement. I'm a lawyer. You're just exquisite. You just touch me in a way that I felt I've been feeling so like I've been feeling so helpless, like even though I have all these tools, right? And I was born in Bangladesh in 71. We dealt with the genocide.
Yeah.
I was born in that time. And so to see this unfold, and so I just wanna say thank you. And it's this, I don't know how long it was, but it's gonna nourish me because we have a big fight. Our students are being arrested.
Yeah.
CUNY is being treated disproportionately than Columbia and Ivy Leagues.
Yeah,
yeah, and black and brown people. So I just wanna say, it's a long way of saying that the way that you construct it is like, I can't do this and I can't do much. And I just wanna say that this is like soul, like, yeah. And I love the word Habibi, like, to me, it's like the best word in the world for like Arabic. It just encompasses everything. It's the child, it's your lover, it's your like, it's gender neutral. Like, I mean, Habibi is the feminine, but yeah.
Right.
Anyway, I just want to say thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Nice. Thank you for all your work to, you know, help our students through this chaos called white supremacy.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you. I'm just playing. I'm melting. It's fine. I can change whatever.
Can I ask you? I still think that academic capitalism is naturally a most important.
Yes.
Something else that you do, I would love to hear like about your work with the Asian Wires and like the history, because I think that's also. This conference has been about Asian American identities, and I think a lot of us are like, this identity needs to be like really, it's so complex, but we don't treat it that way, and we need to broaden it, right? And then see like the solidarity within it. So, I'd just love to know more about the history of climate change, all those good things.
Yeah. Wow, I love this question, because I'm like, oh, it's concise. Okay, so Blazing March, we started during 2020 in the lockdowns, so of course, during the COVID-19, beginnings of the pandemic, and the murder of George Floyd. And for me, it was here in New York, it was really wonderful being able to see so many different iterations of Black Lives Matter that was like specific to like demographics. So you would see like the Black Women's March, there was Black Disabled Lives Matter marches, there was Stonewall for the Queer Community. And I just felt like, you know what, there's no space for Black Asians. We are so invisibilized between both communities, whether we are rejected due to anti-Blackness in one community, or to borrow Toni Morrison, the idea of singular narrative. Like there's a very, very, at least in my experience, there's been a very, very precise definition of how to be Black.
Yeah.
Like how to speak a certain way, the music you listen to, the heritage of well, the unfortunate heritage of surviving mass enslavement and trafficking, which is not every Afro-diasporic experience, but in comes Black Asians, and we are the weird question mark between how Black and Asian communities are triangulated, to borrow Claire Jean Kim's language, triangulated against one another. So that was one part. Another part was within the Asian American communities that I was trying to organize, and the anti-Blackness and the queerphobia became very apparent. And so for me, I was like, all right, for my own healing process, I'm gonna do my own thing. I guess one of my other things I noticed at several BLM actions is that there were so many Asian Americans doing so much behind the scenes work. Like there were so many Asian folks on safety, doing logistics, doing a lot of like remote safety. But at so many of these actions, they were never getting any credit. And I felt it was not appropriate to engage in the idea of liberation while we invisibilize as a community, while we participate in that practice of invisibilizing Asians. So those three weavings kind of created Blazing March. It started October 11th, 2020, and we started, which is also the, unfortunately, the anniversary of the murder of Jennifer Laude, who was a trans Filipina killed by Michael Pemberton, who claimed defense apparently because she had disclosed she was trans. He thought he was being sexually assaulted, and that led to her murder, which we all know is, I can't swear in this academic setting, so.
You can.
Okay, great. We all know that's fucking bullshit, but. So we also, fun fact, we actually launched the Blazing March in Cabin Plaza, which I did not know this much later, but that was actually historically the first Filipino neighborhood in Brooklyn, which was knocked down by the highway. Classic white supremacy. But since then, we have, there have been leaders across the country who are taking the idea into their own accord. There have been Blazing Marches in New Haven, Los Angeles, Chicago, Sacramento. We have also expanded into literature access and literacy justice. So we now have a book fair program where we hand out free books from Black and Asian writers. We also include Native literature because we're on stolen land. We've also done panels featuring only Black Asians. We used to have our affinity space for Black Asians called Blazing is Beautiful. This year, the book fair, after expanding to Sacramento last year, we're doing a book fair in Los Angeles, as well as Orlando, and we're bringing so many banned Black and Asian books down there. I'm the giant pile in my apartment right now. But that, I guess, encapsulates where Blazing March has come from, where it is, and where it goes next, we're going to find out.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Did you have a question too?
Oh.
Oh, you. Okay.
Hi.
Mom, I love this blazer, this color.
What's your favorite Blasian food? Controversial.
Oh my gosh. I love this. Is the last question. Is this the last question? I have no idea. I'm gonna be really horrible and say Jamaican curry. It's not a horrible thing to say. That is a Blasian food. It is an Afro-India fusion, so let's name what it is. I guess what else have I eaten that was really, really good? Oh man, there was one Blasian merch we did. It was like it was our 1 year anniversary, and it was the Black Asian Trans Power Rally, celebrating Black and Asian and Blasian trans folks. And the chef, they did like a Vietnamese Nigerian fusion. And it was like,
it was like,
oh my god, I was like, girl, I am somewhere between heaven and nirvana at which one.
Yeah.
This was here in New York. Yeah.
Thanks,
Sarah.
Thank you.